Stephen King's 11/20/263. Let's start with the forward note. I have never been what you'd call a crying man. My ex-wife said that my non-existent emotional gradient was the main reason she was leaving me, as if the guy she'd met in her AA meetings was besides the point. Chrissy said she supposed that she could forgive me for not crying at her father's funeral. I'd only known him for 6 years and couldn't understand what a wonderful, giving man he had been. Mustang convertible as a high school graduation present, for instance. But then, when I didn't cry at my own parents' funerals, they died just 2 years apart. Dad of stomach cancer, and Mama of a thunderclap heart attack. While walking on a Florida beach, she began to understand the non-existent gradient thing. I was unable to feel my feelings in AA speak. I have never seen you shed tears, she said, speaking in the flat tones people use when they're expressing the absolute final deal breaker in a relationship. Even when you told me I had to go to rehab or you were leaving. This conversation happened about 6 weeks before she packed her things, drove them across town, and moved in with Mel Thomas. Boy meets girl on the AA campus. That's another saying they have in those meetings. I didn't cry when I saw her off. I didn't cry when I went back inside the little house with the great big mortgage either. The house where no baby had come, or now ever would. I just lay down on the bed that now belonged to me alone, and put my arm over my eyes and mourned. Tearlessly, but I'm not emotionally blocked. Christy was wrong about that. One day when I was 9, my mother met me at the door when I came home from school. She told me my collie, Rags, had been struck and killed by a truck that hadn't even bothered to stop. I didn't cry when we buried him, although my dad told me nobody would think less of me if I did. But I cried when she told me, partly because it was my first experience of death, mostly because it had been my responsibility to make sure he was safely penned up in our backyard. And I cried when Mom's doctor called me and told me what had happened that day on the beach. I'm sorry, but there is no chance, he said. Sometimes it's very sudden, and doctors tend to see that as a blessing. Christy wasn't there. She had to stay late at school that day and meet with a mother who had questions about her son's last report card. But I cried all right. I went into our little laundry room and took a dirty sheet out of the basket and cried into that. Not for long, but the tears came. I could have told her about them later, but I didn't see the point. Apparently because she would have thought I was pity fishing. That's not an AA term, but maybe it should be. And partly because I don't think the ability to bust at bawling pretty much on cue should be a requirement for successful marriage. I never saw my dad cry at all. Now that I think about it. At his most emotional, he might fetch a heavy sigh or grunt out a few reluctant chuckles. No breast beating or belly laughs to William Epping. He was the strong, silent type, and for the most part, my mother was the same. So maybe the not crying easily thing is genetic, but blocked? Unable to feel my feelings? No, I have never been those things. Other than when I got the news about Mom, I can only remember one other time when I cried as an adult, and that was when I read the story of the janitor's father. I was sitting alone in the teacher's room at Lisbon High School, working my way through a stack of themes that my adult English class had written. Down the hall, I could hear the thud of basketballs, the blare of the timeout horn, and the shouts of the crowd as the sports beasts fought Lisbon Greyhounds versus Jay Tigers. Who can know when life hangs in the balance, or why? The subject I had assigned was the day that changed my life. Most of the responses were heartfelt but awful. Sentimental tales of a kindly aunt who'd taken in a pregnant teenager. An army buddy who had demonstrated the true meaning of bravery. A chance meeting with a celebrity. Jeopardy host Alex Trebek, I think it was. But maybe it was Carl Malden. The teachers among you who have picked up an extra 3,000 or 4,000 a year by taking on a class of adults studying for the general equivalency diploma will know what a dispiriting job reading such themes can be. The grading process hardly figures into it, or at least didn't for me. I passed everybody because I never had an adult student who did less than try his or her ass off. If you turned in a paper with writing on it, you were guaranteed a hook from Jake Epping of the LHS English department, and if the writing was organized into actual paragraphs, you got at least a B-. What made the job hard was that the red pen became my primary teaching tool instead of my mouth, and I practically wore it out. What made the job dispiriting was that you knew that very little of that red pen teaching was apt to stick. If you reach the age of 25 or 30 without knowing how to spell totally, not totally, or capitalize in the proper places, White House, not White House, or write a sentence containing both a noun and a verb, you're probably never going to. Yet we soldier on, gamely circling the misused words and sentences, like, my husband was too quick to judge me, or crossing out swum and replacing it with swam in the sentence. I swam out to the float often after that. It was such hopeless. Trudging work I was doing that night, while not far away, another high school basketball game wound down toward another final buzzer world without end. Amen. It was not long after Christy got out of rehab, and I suppose if I was thinking of anything, it was to hope that I'd come and find her sober, which I did. She's held on to her sobriety better than she held on to her husband. I remember I had a little headache and was rubbing my temples the way you do when you're trying to keep a little nagger from turning into a big thumper. I remember thinking, three more of these, just three, and I can get out of here. I can go home, fix myself a big cup of instant cocoa, and dive into the new John Irving novel without these sincere but poorly made things hanging over my head. There were no violins or warning bells when I pulled the janitor's theme off the top of the stack and set it before me. No sense that my little life was about to change. But we never know, do we? Life turns on a dime. He had written in cheap ballpoint ink that had blotted the five pages in many places. His handwriting was a looping but legible scrawl, and he must have been bearing down hard because the words were actually engraved into the cheap notebook pages. If I'd closed my eyes and run my fingertips over the backs of those torn-out sheets, it would have been like reading Braille. There was a little squiggle, like a flourish at the end of every lowercase y. I remember that with particular clarity. I remember how his theme started, too. I remember it word for word. It wasn't a day, but a night. The night that changed my life was the night my father murdered my mother and two brothers and hurt me bad. He hurt my sister, too. So bad she went into a coma. In 3 years, she died without waking up. Her name was Ellen, and I loved her very much. She loved to pick flowers and put them in vases. Halfway down the first page, my eyes began to sting, and I put my trusty red pen down. It was when I got to the part about him crawling under the bed with the blood running in his eyes. It also ran down my throat and tasted horrible, that I began to cry. Christy would have been so proud. I read all the way to the end without making a single mark, wiping my eyes so the tears wouldn't fall on the pages that had obviously cost him so much effort. Had I thought he was slower than the rest, maybe only half a step above what used to be called educable retarded, well, by God, there was a reason for that, wasn't there? And a reason for the limp, too. It was a miracle that he was alive at all, but he was. A nice man who had always had a smile and never raised his voice to the kids. A nice man who had been through hell and was working humbly and hopefully, as most of them do, to get a high school diploma. Although he would be a janitor for the rest of his life, just a guy in green or brown khakis, either pushing a broom or scraping gum up off the floor with the putty knife he always kept in his back pocket. Maybe once he could have been something different. But one night his life turned on a dime, and now he was just a guy in cahoots that the kids called Hop-Toed Harry because of the way he walked. So I cried. Those were real tears, the kind that come from deep inside. Down the hall, I could hear the Lisbon band strike up their victory song, so the home team had won, and good for them. Later, perhaps, Harry and a couple of his colleagues would roll up the bleachers and sweep away the crap that had been dropped beneath them. I stroked a big red A on top of his paper, looked at it for a moment or two, then added a big red plus, because it was good, and because his pain had invoked an emotional reaction in me, his reader. And isn't that what A-plus writing is supposed to do? Evoke a response? As for me, I only wish with the former Epping, Christy Epping, had been correct. I wish I had been emotionally blocked after all, because everything that followed, every terrible thing flowed from those tears. That goes into chapter one. Harry Dunning graduated with flying colors. I went to the little GED ceremony in the LHS gym at his invitation. He really had no one else, and I was happy to do it. After the benediction, spoken by Father Bandy, who rarely missed an LHS function, I made my way through the milling friends and relatives to where Harry was standing alone, in his billowy black gown, holding his diploma in one hand and his rented mortarboard in the other. I took his hat so I could shake his hand. He grinned, exposing a set of teeth with many gaps and several leaners, but a sunny and engaging grin for all that. Thanks for coming, Mr. Epping. Thanks so much. It was my pleasure, and you can call me Jake. It's a little perk I accord to students who are old enough to be my father. He looked puzzled for a minute, then laughed. I guess I am, ain't I? Sheesh, I laughed too. Lots of people were laughing all around us, and there were tears, of course. What's hard for me comes easy to a great many people. And that A+, sheesh, I never got A+ in my whole life. Never expected one either. You deserved it, Harry. So what's the first thing you're going to do as a high school graduate? His smile dimmed for a second. That was a prospect he hadn't considered. I guess I'll go back home. I got a little house I rent on Garden Street, you know. He raised the diploma, holding it carefully by the fingertips, as if the ink might smear. I'll frame this and hang it on the wall, and I guess I'll pour myself a glass of wine and sit on the couch and just admire it until bedtime. Sounds like a plan, I said. Would you like to have a burger and some fries with me first? We could go down to Al's. I expected a wince at that. But of course, I was judging Harry by my colleagues, not to mention most of the kids we taught. They avoided Al's like the plague and tended to patronize either the Dairy Queen across from the school or the High Hat out on 196, near where the old Lisbon Drive-In used to be. That'd be great, Mr. Epping, thanks. Jake, remember? Jake, you bet. So I took Harry to Al's, where I was the only faculty regular, and although he actually had a waitress that summer, Al served us himself. As usual, a cigarette. Illegal in public eating establishments, but that never stopped Al. Smoldered in one corner of his mouth, and the eye on the side squinted against the smoke. When he saw the folded-up graduation robe and realized what the occasion was, he insisted on picking up the check. What check there was, the meals were Al's were always remarkably cheap, which had given rise to rumors about the fate of certain stray animals in the vicinity. He also took a picture of us, which he later hung on what he called the town wall of celebrity. Other celebrities represented included the late Albert Dutton, founder of Dutton Jewelry, Earl Higgins, a former LHS principal, John Crafts, founder of John Crafts Auto Sales, and of course Father Bandy of St. Cyril's. The father was paired with Pope John 23, the latter not local, but revered by Al Templeton, who called himself a good Catholic. The picture Al took that day showed Harry Dunning with a big smile on his face. I was standing next to him, and we were both holding his diploma. His tie was pulled slightly askew. I remember that because it made me think of those little squigglies put on the end of his lowercase y's. I remember it all. I remember it very well. 2 years later, on the last day of the school year, I was sitting in the very same teacher's chair, in the very same teacher's room, and reading my way through a batch of final essays my American Poetry Honors seminar had written. The kids themselves had already left, turned loose for another summer, and soon I would do the same. But for the time being, I was happy enough where I was, enjoying the unaccustomed quiet. I thought I might even clean out the snack cupboard before I left. Someone ought to do it, I thought. Earlier that day, Harry Dunning had limped up to me after homeroom period, which being particularly screechy, as all homerooms and study halls tend to be on the last day of school, and offered me his hand. I just want to thank you for everything, he said. I grinned. You already did that, as I remember. Yeah, but this is my last day. I'm retiring, so I wanted to make sure and thank you again. As I shook his hand, a kid cruising by, no more than a sophomore, judging by the fresh crop of pimples and the serial comic straggle on his chin that aspired to goateehood, muttered, "Hopped out, Harry, hopping down the avenue." I grabbed for him, my intention to make him apologize, but Harry stopped me. His smile was easy and unoffended. "Nah, don't bother, I'm used to it, they're just kids." "That's right," I said, "and it's our job to teach him." "I know, and you're good at it. It's not my job to be anybody's, what you call it, teachable moment, especially not today. I hope you'll take care of yourself, Mr. Epping." He might be old enough to be my father, but Jake was apparently always going to be beyond him. "You too, Harry. I'll never forget that A+. I framed that, too. Got it right up beside my diploma. Good for you." And it was. It was all good. His essay had been primitive art, but every bit as powerful and true as a painting by Grandma Moses. It was certainly better than the stuff I was currently reading. The spelling in the honors essays was mostly correct, and the dictation was clear. Although my cautious college-bound don't-take-chances had an irritating tendency to fall back on the passive voice. But the writing was pallid. Boring. My honor kids were juniors. Max Stedman, the department head, awarded the seniors to himself. But they wrote like little old men and little old ladies, all pursy-mouthed and, "Ooh, don't slip on that icy patch, Mildred," in spite of his grammatical lapses and painstaking cursive. Harry Dunning had written like a hero, on one occasion at least. As I was musing on the difference between offensive and defensive writing, the intercom on the wall cleared its throat. "Is Mr. Epping in the West Wing teacher's room? You by any chance still there, Jake?" I got up, thumbed the button, and said, "Still here, Gloria, for my sins. Can I help you?" "You have a phone call. Guy named Al Templeton? I can transfer if you want, or I can tell him you left for the day." Al Templeton, owner and operator of Al's Diner, where all LHS faculty save for years truly refused to go. Even my esteemed department head, who tried to talk like a Cambridge Don and was approaching retirement age himself, had been known to refer to the specialty of the house as Al's famous cat burger instead of Al's famous fat burger. "Well, of course, it's not really cat," people would say, "or probably not cat. But it can't be beef, not at $1.19. "Jake, did you fall asleep on me?" "Nope, wide awake. Also, curious as to why Al would call me at school. Why he'd call me at all, for that matter. Ours had always been strictly a cook and client relationship. I appreciated his chat, and he appreciated my patronage. Go on and put him through. Why are you still here anyway? I'm flagellating myself. Ooh, Gloria said, and I could imagine her fluttering her long lashes. I love it when you talk dirty. Hold on and wait for the ringy-dingy. She clicked off. The extension rang, and I picked up. Jake, you on there, buddy? At first, I thought, Gloria must have gotten the name wrong. That voice couldn't belong to Al. Not even the world's worst cold could have produced such a croak. Who is this? Al Templeton, didn't she tell you? Christ, that whole music really sucks. Whatever happened to Connie Francis? He began to ratchet coughs loud enough to make me hold the phone away from my ears a little. You sound like you got the flu. He laughed. He also kept coughing. The combination was fairly gruesome. I got something, all right. Must have hit you fast. I'd been in just yesterday to grab an early supper. A fat burger, fries, and strawberry milkshake. I believe it's important for a guy living on his own to hit all the major food groups. You could say that, or you could say it took a while. Either one would be right. I didn't know how to respond to that. I'd had a lot of conversations with Al in the 6 or 7 years I'd been going to the diner. And he could be odd, insisted on referring to the New England Patriots as the Boston Patriots, for instance, and talked about Ted Williams as if he'd known him like a brother. But I'd never had a conversation as weird as this. Jake, I need to see you. It's important. Can I ask? I expect you to ask plenty, and I'll answer, but not over the phone. I didn't know how many answers he'd be able to give before his voice gave up, but I promised I'd come down in an hour or so. Thanks. Make it even sooner if you can. Time is, as they say, of the essence. And he hung up. Just like that, without even a goodbye. I worked my way through 2 more of the honor essays, and there were only 4 more on the stack. But it was no good. I'd lost my groove, so I swept the stacks into my briefcase and left. It crossed my mind to go upstairs to the office and wish Gloria a good summer, but I didn't bother. She'd be in all next week, closing the books on another school year, and I was going to come in on Monday and clean out the snack cupboard. That was a promise I'd made to myself. Otherwise, the teachers who used the West Wing teacher's room during summer session would find it crawling with bugs. If I'd known what the future held for me, I certainly would have gone up to see her. I might have even given her the kiss that had been flirting in the air between us the last couple of months. But of course, I didn't know. Life turns on a dime. So that's where I'll leave off for now.